the reasons why we get it this evening is because it's my son Osman's birthday. And generally, you know, practices differ from family to family. But in our family, we generally don't celebrate birthdays. So Osman hasn't really had a birthday before. But his birthday corresponded with the Burda. And it was his request that we host the Burda this evening because it's his birthday. But it's also an opportunity. It's an opportunity because he is 13 years old. Right? He's 13 years old. And one of these days he will become mukallaf. And it's an opportunity for us to impress upon him and all those who are present that whatever myself and my wife, within our capacity, we've taught him the fundamentals of Islam. We taught him the importance of salah. We taught him the importance of Islamic education. We told him, and everyone is witness to this, we've impressed upon him that the most important objective in your life is to please Allah. Not your father, not your mother, not your uncle, not your aunt, not your friends. Your objective in life is to please Allah. And after Allah, we should love nobody and follow nobody and show respect to nobody like you show respect and follow and love to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we impressed upon him that your first objective in life is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes the companions and the pious and then your parents and your grandparents and your friends and all of humanity. Because Islam is a religion that teaches us to show respect to everyone. Al-insaniya. So we impressed upon him this and the importance of his religion. And our request is that everybody prays for him.
Amen.
That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow these lessons and meanings to settle in his heart.
Amen.
And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my intention this evening is actually the lines of the Qasidatul Burda that was recited that speaks specifically of the glorious Quran. I wanted to translate a few of the lines of the Qasida Burda as an advice to Uthman firstly and then to everyone who is present. Because our life should revolve around the Quran. And our request from Uthman is that he takes his memorization of the Quran seriously. There's nothing to do more to insert happiness into the heart of his father and mother greater than memorizing the Quran. So the intention of encouraging all of us, including him, Al-Imam Al-Busiri describes the Quran in the Qasida Burda. The sixth chapter of the Qasida Burda is just a description of the glorious Quran. And he begins the chapter saying that دعني ووصفي آيات له ظهر ظهورنا للقراء ليلا على علمي. So, Imam Al-Busiri is a poet. And many of us, we haven't developed an appreciation for poetry. Poetry is taking examples that you are familiar with and then, you know. So he said that, allow me to describe to you signs, or you can say verses, or you could just leave it in Arabic and say ayat. Allow me to describe to you ayat lahu dhahar, that has appeared through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Dhuhura nar al-qira. How clear are these signs? So he draws us an example. And even though in the present world we don't witness this any longer, but one of the ways in which you would honor guests was to have lights burning. So you have a guest arriving at night. And in honor of your guest, you would have lights burning upon mountaintops or upon hills or sometimes in the road. Right? And he said that these signs, or these miracles, or these verses that has come to us via Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is so apparent and so clear, so clearly indicating to the fact that he is a prophet of Allah, so clearly indicating to the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our creator. He said, "Dhuhura nar al-qira," as clearly as those lights would appear that are lit for guests that are arriving at night. Now, we can understand that because we don't come from a community where there's no electricity, number one. And we don't come from an Arab society where guests would be honored in this particular way. But if I could perhaps draw a summary for us to perhaps understand, New Year's Eve, if you were to travel to every street, you'll find lights shining in the road. And as clear as those lights are, so clear is the truthfulness of the message of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So clear are the signs that has come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, Ayatu Haqqin, speaking of the Quran, he said, these are verses of truth. Min al-Rahmani, that has come from Allah, the most merciful. Then he said, Muhdathatun. It's actually something very difficult to wrap your mind around. Just imagine when I recite a hadith of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I say, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. A common hadith that you all know, indeed, actions are only valid with intentions. Or some translate it as, are judged according to intentions. Even though I have a problem with the second translation. So actions are only valid with intentions. Think about it. You pronounce words that emanated from the mouth of the best of Allah's creation, Sayyidina Mawlana Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As you utter, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ, you are reading words that came from the mouth of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the Quran is whose words?
Allah.
When you're reading words that come from Allah, when you recite these words, it's as if these words have been pronounced now. So it's been revealed in time. Or you can say the Quran is recited in time. However, the Quran is, he said, قَدِيمَةٌ, it's eternal. It doesn't have a beginning. You're reciting words that have no beginning and have no end.
SubhanAllah.
You're immortal, you are weak, you live in time, you are restricted by time, you are restricted by space, but Allah is favoring you and allowing you to read words that have no beginning.
SubhanAllah.
Words that have no end. Words that are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just as mind-boggling. Every time I recite the Quran, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, I'm reading the words of my Creator, the Creator of everything I see. Everything in existence, the one who created all of that, His words, His kalam that has no beginning and no end, I'm reciting that words. So, He said, قَدِيمَةٌ, as a quality of Al-Mawsuf Bil-Qidam, it's a quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is eternal. And then, of course, we cannot comment on the whole. He said, دَامَتْ لَدَيْنَا, this miracle which is the Quran that has come to us back from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, دَامَتْ لَدَيْنَا, it still remains today. It's a miracle that was revealed 1437 years ago. And it's still a miracle today. Allah challenged people in the Quran to bring the like of the Quran. Until this present day, no one was able to bring the like of the Quran. Can you imagine? It's such a clear sign, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to every disbeliever, if you think that the Quran is not the word of Allah, then come together, have conferences, have functions, every single non-Muslim from the time of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the last person on earth, come together and try to bring one verse that is similar to the Quran. One verse. And then no one has gathered, no one has tried, no one has attempted, because the Quran is the greatest miracle of Allah. Greatest miracle. It's such a simple challenge. Gather me and bring a verse like the Quran. But they cannot. Till today, no one can stand up to take on the challenge that Allah mentions in the Quran. So he said, فَابَ كُلَّ مُعْجِزَةٍ, the Quran is greater than every other miracle that has come to earth. Nabi Isa alayhi salam gave life to the dead. Came back to the dead. Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam made dua, and a bird that was chopped up and placed on different mountains came flying together. But the greatest miracle was the miracle that came to us via the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it's a glorious Quran. فَقَدْ كُلَّ مُعْجِزَةٍ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ إِنْ جَاءَكْ وَلَمْ تَجُمِنْ. You see, the Quran is a miracle that remains still today, and it is greater than every other miracle that came from any other prophet, because that miracle is not with us today. It happened and it's gone, but the Quran is still witnessed. He said that لَهَا مَعَانِي. Everyone should have a desire to understand the Quran, and to study the Quran, and to memorize the Quran, and to delve into the oceans of meanings of the Quran. So he said, لَهَا مَعَانٍ كَمَوْجِ الْبَحْرِ فِي مَدَدٍ. The meanings of the Quran, okay? What the poet does, he wants to draw a picture to you. And it's very easy for us to understand this picture. If you go to Muesenberg, and you sit looking at the ocean, what do you see? You see one wave after the next wave, after the next wave, after the next wave. You can sit there from Fajr till Dhuhr, the waves are still coming. From Dhuhr till Asr, the waves are still coming. Asr till Maghrib, the waves are still coming. At night, even though you cannot see, you can hear the waves are still breaking. You find your way into the waves are still flowing. So you see, the Quran is such meanings like the waves of the sea. Just flowing and flowing and flowing and continuing. And there's no end to the meanings of the Quran. لَهَا مَعَانٍ كَمَوْجِ الْبَحْرِ فِي مَدَدٍ وَفَوْقَ جَوْهَرِي فِي الْحُسْنِ وَالْقِيَمِ. But in terms of beauty and in terms of perfection and in terms of value, the Quran is greater than every jewel and emerald that is held within the ocean. وَفَوْقَ جَوْهَرِي فِي الْحُسْنِ وَالْقِيَمِ. So he said, فَمَا تُعَدُّ وَلَا تُقْصَى عَجَائِبُهَا. The wonders of the Quran, the wonders, the amazing facts, the wonders of the Quran cannot be enumerated, cannot be counted, cannot be listed. And therefore today you can write a tafsir. And next year another person will write a tafsir, a commentary on the Quran. And tafsir will be written. Today we have comfortably thousands of tafsir commentaries that have been written on the Quran. And still everything has not been listed. Still people are finding new meanings in the Quran. Still they're discovering miracles that are promised on the pages of the Quran. It's just no end to it. فَمَا تُعَدُّ وَلَا تُحْصُ عَجَائِبُهَا وَلَا تُسَامُ عَلَى الْإِكْثَارِ بِالسَّأَمِ. And the one who recites the Quran excessively will never become tired of reciting the Quran. So we need to develop a love for the Book of Allah. We need to all start reciting the Quran. In our scholars, our mashayikh from Hadramaut, and when Wasim spoke about the scholars of Hadramaut, we've witnessed amazing things when it came to the recitation of the Quran. Said Habib Umar, he speaks of some of the Habaib, and he mentions that there was one Habib whose name slips my mind. He said that reciting the Quran was such a pleasure for him that whenever he recited the Quran, he would find the taste of honey in his mouth.
Allah.
It was sweet. Sweet. The Habib did not recite Quran during the day of Ramadan. He said, the day of Ramadan I should feel hungry. I should stay away from food. But when I recite the Quran, I find the taste of honey in my mouth. And then I become full. So what's the use I for? So he said, I don't recite it during the day, and whole night you spend reciting the Quran.
Allah.
There was one Habib, whose name was Sister Shamayn. He was so engrossed in the recitation of the Quran, he would forget what is happening around him. So one morning he left home after Fajr, after Ijraq, on a camel. And he was sitting on the camel, and he was reciting Quran, and as he was reciting, He just lost himself in the recitation of the Quran. And then they found him Dhuhratan. From Ijraq, Fajr, they found him Dhuhratan. What happened? The camel who about 20 meters from his home, and he was supposed to travel to a different city. And then the camel sat down. And he didn't know the camel sat. And he recited, and initially Dhuhratan, they told him, Habib, you're sitting here, your camera is just like the Quran, you know where you are. So he said, I'm supposed to be in the city, so and so. So he said, you're only 10 meters away from your home. But he just recited. So, like some of the Habaib recited up to 4 khatams of the Quran a day. So, in their lifestyle, is a beautiful example for us in terms of the attachment to the Quran. And we see that in our teacher said, Habib Umar, because his attachment to the Quran is similarly mind boggling. The amount of Quran he recites on a daily basis is unbelievable. Never mind, Ramadan is normal day. So, I'd love to share with Uthman and all our brothers the importance of attaching ourselves to the Book of Allah. Studying the Quran. The most important thing with regards to the Quran is reading. Is reading. Today you can become a hafiz of the Quran, but you're not reciting the Quran, then of what use is that you're a hafiz of the Quran? We need to recite the Quran every day of our life, without fail. The Book of Allah must be in my home every day. So make that intention for mine and for everyone else that we'll be reciting the Quran every day of our lives. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. Allah make us memorize the Quran. And then beyond that, may Allah allow us to understand the language of the Quran. And then beyond that, may Allah allow us to study the tafsir of the Quran. And then beyond that, may Allah allow us to study the law of the Quran. So that our lives become the Quran. That eventually we can leave the stage. As Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha described the Prophet, which he said that, describe Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to ask him, she said, he was the Quran.
Allah.
He can khuluqu al-Quran. Everything about him was Quran. So maybe he became. Today we have a sect in our society, they call themselves Quraniyun. If you want to translate that, you could say Quranist. And what they mean by Quranist is that they only follow the Quran, they don't follow the Sunnah. Which is very contradictory, because the Quran tells you to follow the Sunnah.
Allah.
May Allah make us true Quraniyun. That our morning is Quran, our day is Quran, our night is Quran. And being the Quran means you are like the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then we conclude again with the poem that Shaykh Muhammad recited. وَعَلَمْ Know that all good, if you've been listening attentively, lies in the following of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who is our intercessor tomorrow. May Allah grant us all the intercession of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.